Do you have a spare screen and can't connect it to your MacBook? Or maybe you want to make your meeting room display or beamer capable of Airplay mirroring? Maybe you're a voice actor like I am, and you might want a wirelessly connected screen in your booth. You can do that using a Raspberry Pi and some software called UxPlay. In this video, I will show you how I did it. So what do you need? Well, besides a screen or beamer, you'll need a Raspberry Pi. I'm using a Raspberry Pi 3B, but if you happen to have a newer model, you should be golden. People even mentioned running it on a Pi Zero, which is really cheap if you still need to buy one. I also tried it on a first generation Pi, but although the software tells me it runs fine, nothing appeared on the screen when I selected from my MacBook. If you know how to solve that, I'd be happy to learn from you. Apart from this, you'll need a microSD card for the operating system. I'm using a 16GB one, which is more than enough for this little project. You'll need a power source for your Pi, preferably the official Raspberry Pi power supply or a decent phone charger. I tried it with this one, that's capable of only 1 amp power, and it worked as long as I disabled Bluetooth, but that's really pushing it. And of course an HDMI cable to connect your screen to the Pi. To write the OS to the SD card, you'll also need something of a card reader. I'm using this cheap thing, but anything will work. The easiest way to get a write OS for your Pi is to download the Raspberry Pi imager. Let's open a browser and head to raspberrypi.com. Click on software, scroll down a bit and click on the download link. I'm not going to tell you how to install it. If that's too much for you, then this video might not be for you. Oh, hey, look, it's installed. All right. I insert the microSD card into my card reader, plug it in and run the software. Mine is in Dutch, but it should look kinda the same on other systems. You can choose your model on the left, the OS you want in the center, and the card on which you want to write the OS on the right. Strangely enough though, when I select my third generation Pi, I can only choose the legacy variants of the Raspberry Pi OS, which is weird because it is supported on the latest and greatest. So I pick no filtering and then select the Raspberry Pi OS, which is based on Debian 12 or Bookworm at the moment. You can use the Lite OS if you want, but I spent more time than I'd like to admit on audio through HDMI on that, so I figured it would be easier to just get a full-blown desktop variant and then disable the desktop. Now I select the SD card. Please make very sure that you select the right one, because the imager will completely wipe it. Click next and it will ask me if I want to customize the OS. I do. I choose a name for the little machine, a username and a password, and I choose to enter my Wi-Fi SSID and password, which was already there because I did this before, so you've got an internet connection from the start. You can configure that later though using the raspi-config command or on the desktop by right-clicking the network icon. Okay, let's go. Depending on the speed of your card, this might take a while. Now the process is complete. I remove the card from my card reader and feed it to the Pi. As soon as the power supply is connected, the thing starts to boot. The first time this will take a bit longer than afterwards because it will resize the partition and I guess some other magic things like adding the customization we've done before. Alright, here we are. To enable audio through HDMI, right click on the speaker icon and choose HDMI. Simple as that. Now open a terminal and try to play a sound.
Center.
Alright, that works. Since I don't need a full desktop environment, I'm going to turn it off right now. To disable it, I open raspi-config, open system options, choose boot auto login and select the first. I don't like the splash screen either, so I turn that off as well. And reboot. Ah yes, a nice old school text display, just the way I like it. So how to actually install UxPlay? Well, the easiest solution is just to install it using apt. It's an outdated version, but it still works quite well. Let's do that first. First I'll do an apt-get update, just to be sure, and install UxPlay. Alright, now run it. This seems to take a little longer the first time, not sure why, but alright, here we are. Let's give it a quick test. Okay, that happens when you mirror the same screen on which the screen itself is being captured, so... But hey, it works. So, let's disconnect and I'll show you how to get the latest version. As you can see, there have been some interesting developments since version 1.62 was released. If you're happy with the performance of the package version though, you might want to skip to the next chapter of this video. First, let's install some build tools. And the dependencies for UxPlay. Alright, let's clone the UxPlay Git repository. Cool, now head into the UxPlay directory, create a build directory and enter that. Now run cmake followed by two dots, this creates a build environment in our build directory. That looks good. Now run make and wait for the 100% mark. Now the software is compiled, it's time to install. Run sudo make install and run it. Note that I'm providing the full path. That's because I also have the package version installed and I want to make sure I start the right one. Okay, let's test it. I'll have my MacBook connect to it and... Whoa! Okay, let's switch to a non-mirroring setup for now. Alright, that works. Let's disconnect. Now, I want to automatically start it at boot, so I'll install a service. I have pre-set up one for you at bit.ly/uxplay-service. Let's get it. When you open the file, you see the full path to the executable. If you're using the packaged version, then change use our local bin to use our bin. If you like to add options, for example to disable sound, just add them like this. If you're running under a different username, change it here from UxPlay to whatever the user is you're using. Save any changes you've made and copy the file to /etc/systemd/system and give it a proper name ending at .service. Now we can enable the service just like any other. Whoa, sudo! While we're at it, I feel it's a good idea to remove some unnecessary services like cups, since we're not going to do any printing on this one. And the modem manager, since we're not using that either. And Bluetooth, for the same reason. I will even go as far as disable Bluetooth completely in /boot/config.txt by adding dt-overlay-is-disabled-bt. This will save a bit of power. Let's reboot and see if everything still works. Connect again and woohoo! One last thing before we wrap this up. I want to be able to turn it off, but I will not have a keyboard connected and I'm sure as hell not going to SSH into this box just to shut it down. I want to be able to power it off. This, however, can cause file system issues to the point of your Pi not going to boot anymore. I don't want that. So let's make it read-only. Open raspi-config again. Now go to performance options and select the overlay file system option. This will make your Pi boot in a read-only file system and adds an overlay that makes everything work as normal, except for the fact that changes will not be written to the SD card. So make sure you're happy with your setup before doing this. Would I like the overlay file system to be enabled? Why yes, of course! Would I like to have the boot file system write protected? Yes, please! Would I like to reboot now? I thought you'd never ask. The swap file service throws an error. That probably has something to do with the overlay we just created. I suppose I could have disabled it before doing this. I can't say I care. So there you have it, Airplay on a Raspberry Pi. I'm very happy with my wireless screen. It's perfectly fine for a static display and it will even do some basic animation. Don't expect to watch a movie or play fast-paced games on this. For everything else, it should do fine. I hope you like this video. Thanks for watching. Until next time.